morning.
Good morning.
Are we all good?
Yes.
All right. It's good to be here today, to be able to worship God. I can sense that we are all happy to be here. We're all excited to be here. Yes, I haven't been here for a very long time. I see some faces haven't been here for over a year now. It's good to see all your faces. Any celebrations, birthdays, anniversaries? Yes?
It's our 61st wedding anniversary.
61st.
Beach.
So we will not be having our hymns up on the projector, on the screen, but we will sing from our hymn books today. And so our first song is the Rock of Ages. 273, Rock of Ages.
We pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Our readings this morning, the first one comes from the book of Hebrews, chapter 4, verses 12 to 16. Then we'll get the gospel according to Mark, chapter 10, verses 17 to 31. We listen to the word. Hebrews chapter 4, verses 12 to 16, and Mark chapter 10, verses 17 to 31.
Good morning, everyone. I'm doing the reading from Hebrews. We read from verse 12. The word of God is alive and active, sharper than any double-edged sword. It cuts all the way through to where soul and spirit meet, to where joints and marrow come together. It judges the desires and thoughts of man's heart. There is nothing that can be hidden from God. Everything in all creation is exposed and lies open before his eyes. And it is to him that we must all give an account of ourselves. Jesus, the great high priest. Let us then hold firmly to the faith we profess, for we have a great high priest who has gone into the very presence of God, Jesus, the Son of God. Our high priest is not one who cannot feel sympathy for our weaknesses. On the contrary, we have a high priest who was tempted in every way that we are, but did not sin. Let us have confidence then and approach God's throne where there is grace. There we will receive mercy and find grace to help us just when we need it.
I'm reading from Mark 10, verses 17 to 31, entitled The Rich Man.
As Jesus was starting on his way again, a man ran up, knelt before him and asked him, "Good teacher, what must I do to receive eternal life?" "Why do you call me good?" Jesus asked him. "No one is good except God alone. You know the commandments. Do not commit murder. Do not commit adultery. Do not steal. Do not accuse anyone falsely. Do not cheat. Respect your father and mother." "Teacher," the man said, "ever since I was young, I've obeyed all these commandments." Jesus looked straight at him with love and said, "Need only one thing. Go and sell all you have and give the money to the poor, and you will have riches in heaven. Then come and follow me." When the man heard this, gloom spread over his face, and he went away sad, because he was very rich. Jesus looked round at his disciples and said to them, "How hard it will be for rich people to enter the kingdom of God." The disciples were shocked at their words, but Jesus went on to say, "My children, how hard it is to enter the kingdom of God. It is much harder for a rich person to enter the kingdom of God than for a camel to go to the eye of a needle." At this, the disciples were completely amazed and asked one another, "Who then can be saved?" Jesus looked straight at them and answered, "This is impossible for man, but not for God. Everything is possible for God." Then Peter spoke up, "Look, we have left everything and followed you." "Yes," Jesus said to them, "and I tell you that anyone who leaves home for brothers and sisters or mother or father or children or fields for me and for the gospel will receive much more in this present age. He will receive 100 times more houses, brothers, sisters, mothers, children, and fields, and persecutions as well. And in the age to come, he will receive eternal life. But many who are now first will be last, and many who are last will now be first." This is the word of God.
Thanks be to God. Thank you, friends. And so we join our voices once more. We sing the hymn, "Amazing Grace." That is 215. "Amazing Grace."
Amazing grace.
yes, yes.
You
must be introducing yourself.
Oh,
just give us your name and where you're from. Schools of Weya. Okay. From? From Deep River, you're in Deep River. Okay, we warmly welcome you. Thank you for coming to worship with us this morning. Yeah, I saw that. I don't know your face. I've been here for quite some time, eh? Yeah, and these flowers are beautiful.
Yeah.
Yeah, they are beautiful. I can imagine how I look. From a text in Hebrews 4:12, the author tells us that the Word of God is living. That means the author is trying to indicate its power and relevance. And because the Word of God is living, it is therefore active and sharper than any two-edged sword. And so the activity of the word takes the form of piercing to the division of soul and spirit and joints and marrow. That is, thoroughly searching out and exposing the innermost secrets of the sons of man. So what we learn from the writer of the Hebrews is that the Word of God is not simply a collection of words from God. It is living, it is life-changing as it works in us. That's what he teaches us. That God's Word reveals who we are and what we are not. It penetrates the core of our moral and spiritual life. It discerns what is within us, both good and evil. So that's what this text teaches us. But allow me to lift up 3 points, because that's what we were taught as Methodist preachers. Try to come up with 3 things you have learned from the sermon. So that this is to show that I am still a Methodist preacher. You know, actually this says this is my 5th year here. So in the years that I have been here, as I am preparing my exit, you know, you have affirmed Methodism in me. So you haven't changed me, thank you. The only thing that has changed is that I came here with my old teeth, strong and firm. But I'm about to lose 2 of them now. You know. 2 of them are very loose and hear that they can, you know, can fall any time. So maybe this affirms the suspicions we had or we continue to have from those who are from the Eastern Cape. You know, our suspicions about Cape Town, that if you come to Cape Town, you're going to lose all your teeth. that's what we know, the Eastern Cape people, that's what we know about Cape Town. You go to Cape Town, you come back with no teeth. That's what we know. So I want to lift up 3 things this morning. And the first one, which I've read, you know, I've learned from this passage, is that we are exposed before God. That's the first point. We are exposed before God. All are laid bare before God. God knows all about us. Nothing can be hidden from God. He knows about everyone, everywhere, and everything about us is wide open to his all-seeing eyes. So we are exposed before God. That's what the writer of Hebrews tells us. God sees all we do and knows all we think. Even when we are unaware of his presence, he is there. When we try to hide from him, he sees us. This means we can have no secrets from God. And I think this is the answer to the man who comes from God and say, what do I need to do to inherit eternal life? We can have no secrets from God. God knows the things we do. And so it is comforting to realize that although God knows us intimately, he still loves us. And so when we have a sad and sorry tale to tell, when life has drenched us with the tears of tears, we do not go to a God who is quite incapable of understanding what has happened to us. But we go to a God who knows it all. A God who has been there and has seen it all. So God knows our problems because he has come through them. And so it says, the best person to give you advice and help on a journey is someone who has come through it. And in this case, God can help because he knows it all. We are exposed before God. He knows every thought and attitude. No matter how hard people try to hide their sins, the truth will eventually come to the light, and they will be expected to give account because nothing in all creation is hidden from God's sight. Everything is uncovered and laid bare before his eyes. So that is the first point. We are exposed before God. So whatever you do, wherever you are, you need to know that God sees you. The all-seeing eye of God sees you where you are because we are exposed before God. We can't hide anything before God. All are laid bare before God. But the second thing that I believe the writer of the Hebrews tells us is that God sympathizes with us. The first thing is that we are exposed before God. But the second thing is that God sympathizes with us, which says to us, God is interested in the affairs of our lives. God is interested in the affairs of your life because he cares, because he sympathizes with us. Because I'm saying this, because there are those who think God does not know or he does not care. And this writer is saying that's not the case. Because he says we have a high priest who is able to sympathize with our weaknesses. Jesus is not someone who is far above mankind, that he cannot empathize with our condition. It is as Paul writes, it says, Jesus, being very nature God, did not consider equality with God something to be grasped, but made himself nothing, taking the very nature of a servant, being made in human likeness. Therefore, the astonishing truth is, we have one who has been tempted in every way, just as we are, yet was without sin. So while God cuts through the fog of our lives and knows us inside and out, we can remain confident because God sympathizes with us. You know, now it's time for elections. The politicians are all over our streets. You know, I see many of them, you know, visiting people's houses. They even doing people's washings and all those things. Because they're asking for some of them are asking for a second chance for them. For the 28th. And so as we prepare for these municipal elections, they try to tell us that they know what we go through. They know our challenges, they know our difficulties, they know our pain. That's what they're telling us.
But the truth is, no one truly knows what we are going through unless he or she has lived as we have lived. And so a huge impersonal government can never know what the common man, the common woman feels. Government cannot feel our pain, nor can it solve the sinful condition of human hearts. But God can and did. So here in the book of Hebrews, we are reminded that we follow a Savior who knows our circumstances because he himself lived as we live and died to rise again. So he could identify with our condition. He could identify with our circumstances. So rather than being fearful of God, we can be confident because God sympathizes with us. And so he says, even in this time of a pandemic, as we suffer, there is a God suffering with us because he sympathizes with us. That's what this author is telling us. So we are exposed before God. Secondly, God sympathizes with us. But the third thing is that we can be confident in approaching God. That's the third point. Let us therefore approach the throne of grace with confidence, so that we may receive mercy and find grace to help us in our time of need. So Hebrews admonishes, let us then approach the throne of grace with confidence. So the author is reminding us to have no fear, no trembling, and no wondering if God truly loves us or not. So the beautiful miracle is that all who trust in Christ can confidently approach the throne of grace. God's throne has become to us a throne of grace through the mediation of our high priest at God's right hand. So this says, take a moment to take in this beautiful truth. No matter what sin we struggle with, and no matter how we may feel at the time, we, the children of God, may come at any time to God's throne so that we may receive mercy and find grace to help us in our time of need. So we can be confident in approaching God. Remember, Jesus taught us and said, ask and it will be given to you. Seek and you will find. Knock and the door will be opened for you. For everyone who asks receives. He who seeks finds, and to him who knocks the door will be opened. So this text says to us, do not be anxious about anything, but in everything, by prayer and petition, with thanksgiving, present your requests to God. Be confident in approaching God. So we all need confidence. But the question is, where does true confidence come from? It only comes from Christ. And so if your confidence is coming from any other source, it will fail in the end. If your confidence is coming from any other source, it will fail. So in conclusion, we are exposed before God, yet God sympathizes with us, and we therefore can be confident in approaching God. In this generation, confidence, I know, is found in the world. Confidence is found in status, in relationships. Confidence is found in money, in riches, in cars, in houses, in clothes, beauty. Confidence is found in achievements, in education, goals, popularity, etc. But God wants us to have confidence in him. And having confidence in God, meaning not boastful, arrogant pride, but an assured knowledge of who we are in him. Our self-worth should be seen through the eyes of our We are exposed before God, that God sympathizes with us, and we can be confident in approaching God. Amen. We're going to sing now the Lord's Prayer, and after we have sung the Lord's Prayer, we will pray the intercessory prayers. Come, let us sing the Lord's Prayer.
Accept these prayers
for the sake of your Son, our risen Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. And so now we move to the time of communion. I believe that all of us, we have our communion next to us and ready to share. Peace of the Lord be with you. May you please share peace with those behind and in front of you just by waving your hand. All right, we're going to follow our order of service from page B12. Our order of service from page B12, we're going to follow that. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. For the all-powerful and ever-living God, it is indeed right. It is our joy and our salvation, always and everywhere, to give you thanks and praise. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord. You created all things and made us in your own image. When we had fallen into sin, you gave your only Son to be our Savior. He shared our human nature and died on the cross. You raised him from the dead and exalted him to your right hand in glory, where he lives forever to pray for us. Through him you have sent your holy and life-giving Spirit and made us your people, a royal priesthood, to stand before you, to proclaim your glory and celebrate your mighty deeds. And so with all the company of heaven, we join in the unending hymn of praise.
Glory, 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 O Lord, God of power and might, even in death are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest.
We praise you, Lord God, King of the universe, through our Lord Jesus Christ, who on the night in which he was betrayed, took bread and gave thanks, broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, take this and eat it, this is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. In the same way, after supper, he took the cup. He gave thanks and gave it to them, saying, drink from it, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, poured out for you and for many, for the forgiveness of sins. Do this whenever you drink it, in remembrance of me.
Christ is
the Lord. Father, as he has commanded us, we do this in remembrance of him. And we ask you to accept our sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving. Grant that by the power of the Holy Spirit, we who receive your gifts of bread and wine may share in the body and blood of Christ. Make us one body with him. Accept us as we offer ourselves to be a living sacrifice, and bring us with the whole creation to your heavenly kingdom. We ask this through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Through him, with him, in him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory to the Almighty God and Father, from all the God and earth and heaven, throughout all ages. Amen.
The bread we break is a sharing in the body of Christ. We pray together the prayer of humble blessings. Lord, we come to your table, trusting in your mercy, and not in any goodness of our own. We are not worthy to carry out the crumbs under your table, but it is your nature to always have mercy, and on that we depend. So lead us to the body and blood of Jesus Christ, your Son, that we may forever live in him, and he with us. Amen. And so now we're going to share as we open the water in the struggle. Bread is the body of our Lord Jesus Christ, which was broken on Mount Calvary for the forgiveness of our sins. We take and eat by faith and with thanksgiving.
next layer. This is the blood of our Lord Jesus Christ, which was shed on Mount Calvary for the forgiveness of our sins. We take and drink by faith and with thanksgiving. You can throw it in the basket next to you.
Thank you.
Thank you so much. You go well.